What's up, guys? Nuance Bro checking in, and today we're going to be talking about a few stories, some recent and some not so recent, involving China, the Chinese, and some of their spying and espionage activities in the United States and on Americans in general. Now, at first I wanted to do a video about a very particular story, but then as I was trying to make the video, every single day it seemed like new information was coming out dealing with China and their espionage in the United States. So we're gonna try to cover the stories one by one and basically kind of try to tie them all together. Now, as you might have heard, there's been a recent controversy involving some US politicians and a particular female spy from China. In an exclusive story from Axios, suspected Chinese spy targeted California politicians. And here we can see a Chinese woman taking pictures with various politicians at different levels of government, both national and local. And most notably is this top left picture here where she is with U.S. Representative Eric Swalwell, a member of Congress. The woman at the center of the operation, a Chinese national named Feng Feng or Christine Feng, targeted up-and-coming local politicians in the Bay Area and across the country who had the potential to make it big on the national stage. And as we mentioned before, among the most significant targets of Feng's efforts was Representative Eric Swalwell of California. Now, it looks like she worked on some fundraising activities in Swalwell's 2014 re-election campaign, and she apparently helped place at least one intern in Swalwell's office. A statement from Swalwell's office provided to Axios said, quote, Representative Swalwell long ago provided information about this person, whom he met more than 8 years ago and whom he hasn't seen in nearly 6 years, to the FBI. To protect information that might be classified, he will not participate in your story. So of course, in 2015, when the FBI gave him notice saying that they suspected Ms. Feng of being a Chinese spy, Swalwell cut off all ties with Ms. Feng. Now, here's the interesting thing, because Ms. Feng wasn't just showing up to fundraisers and everybody just seemed to open the door to her for no reason. She was getting busy behind the scenes, if you know what I mean. According to the same Axios story, she also engaged in sexual or romantic relationships with at least two mayors of Midwestern cities over a period of about 3 years, according to one U.S. intelligence official and one former elected official. At least two separate sexual interactions with elected officials, including one of these Midwestern mayors, were caught on FBI electronic surveillance of Feng, according to two intelligence officials. And apparently this was some mayor in Ohio, and the sexual activity was caught happening in the back of a car. So people are rightfully asking, was Swalwell sexually involved with this woman? And his office has declined to comment for national security reasons. Yeah. Now, understandably, a lot of Democrats were trying to distance themselves from Feng, saying, oh, we don't even remember seeing her. You know, she might have seen her one time at some event or something like that. So everybody was trying to distance themselves. Swalwell saying, oh, 2015, cut off all communication, never spoke to her again after the FBI warned me. But apparently, his family members were still friends with her on Facebook and even leaving comments and things like that on her pictures. Even after this story broke. As we can see here, the story's been updated. Swalwell's dad, brother, no longer Facebook friends with Chinese spy after reports on continued ties. And we can see here, earlier Wednesday, they were still friended years after the FBI flagged her for suspicious activities and the congressman cut her off. Later in the day, following reporting on the connections, their accounts no longer appeared on her friends list. And it's just so interesting that Swalwell, of all people, would be someone involved in being engaged with a Chinese spy, having them kind of working in his campaign, having his family be friends with them on Facebook, because this is one of the guys who was coming at the Trump administration and his family the hardest for, you know, unknowingly meeting with someone that they suspected of being a Russian spy, as you could probably remember in this clip.
Well, I think we've all gotten a PhD in Russian studies that none of us signed up for. But stated plainly, the president's son met with a Russian spy. We now have the best evidence of that in our minority report the Democrats put out, that Miss Veselnitskaya was going all over the world and bumping into Dana Rohrabacher, which is a sign of a spy, someone who tries to create, you know, a coincidence encounter. And now we know that she was working at the behest of the Russian government. The president's son, Nicole, met with a Russian spy, but also at that meeting was Paul Manafort. So Paul Manafort knows he's in a meeting where he knows the premise is dirt is being offered on the campaign's opponent, and he has this side relationship with a former GRU officer, a Russian military officer, and now we know is sharing internal campaign polling data. So you see from all individuals here, from the president's son to his son-in-law to his campaign chairman, an eagerness and a willingness to work with the Russians. What that materialized to, I think at this point only special counsel knows, but thankfully Democrats on the Intelligence Committee in very short order are going to be in a position to understand.
So it's interesting that Swalwell, of all people, was calling out the president and his family for meeting with a suspected Russian spy when he, just a few years earlier, was involved, potentially in more ways than one, with a Chinese spy who he let get an intern into his office, and whose his family was still friends with this Chinese spy even after he learned that this was a Chinese spy. They were friends with them on Facebook. Now, if you think this situation is a sort of one-off situation and, you know, this is okay, this one Chinese spy was involved with some of these politicians, whatever, it might be a unique case. Well, no, according to intelligence officials, there could be thousands of people just like this Chinese spy. As we can see here in this article from Fox News, China's extensive honey trap spy network could involve thousands of ploys underway now, ex-operative says. Quote, I can say with a high level of confidence that there are many more of these women out there, Daniel Hoffman, a retired CIA senior clandestine services officer, told Fox News. China's MO is to flood the zone. So this is an organized effort by the Chinese to gain intelligence and also influence politicians and policy. Another example of a prominent politician being targeted by the Chinese is Senator Dianne Feinstein. As we can see in this San Francisco Chronicle article from 2018, Feinstein had a Chinese spy connection she didn't know about, her driver. And we can see here, according to a Politico magazine story on Silicon Valley espionage, the Feinstein staffer was suspected of providing political intelligence, but nothing classified, to his handlers, with one former intelligence official telling author Zach Dorfman that the suspected informant was run by officials based at the local Chinese consulate. And keep in mind, at the time of this incident, Dianne Feinstein was the then chairwoman of the Senate Intelligence Committee. Now, when it comes to Dianne Feinstein, her and her China connections go back decades, all the way from her time as San Francisco mayor to her time as senator leading up to today. It's pretty crazy. So we're not going to go into all of it. That's a whole thing you can look into yourself. But, you know, you can also look at her vested interests, you know, along with her husband, that they have in China. Keep in mind, Dianne Feinstein is married to a billionaire who has, you know, interests in China from a business perspective. As we can see in this Los Angeles Times article from 1997, Feinstein's husband holds strong China connections. On Capitol Hill, Senator Dianne Feinstein of California has emerged as one of the staunchest proponents of closer U.S. relations with China, fighting for permanent most favored nation trading status for Beijing. At the same time, far from the spotlight, Feinstein's husband, Richard C. Bloom, has expanded his private business interests in China to the point that his firm is now a prominent investor inside the communist nation. So it's interesting how we always hear about Russia and the Republicans, specifically Trump, but we almost never hear much from the media when it comes to the Democrats and China, because it's almost exclusively China dealing with the Democrats when it comes to these sorts of things. It's always them being implicated. Another example of that, by the way, which was widely denied and is now not really being covered by the media for saving face reasons, is the Hunter Biden allegations. As we can see here, once again from Fox News, Hunter Biden tax affairs under federal investigation links to China funds emerge, sources say. The investigation, according to a source familiar, began in 2018. So this story that the media was saying, oh, this was Russian disinformation, you heard Joe Biden saying it constantly on the campaign trail that it was Russian disinformation, all these intelligence officials say it has the hallmarks of Russian disinformation, we now know was a real story. And the FBI has been investigating it for 2 years. So as you can see, the Chinese are quite sophisticated when it comes to monitoring our politics here in the United States. In fact, they even keep a detailed list of politicians and their favorability towards China. As we can see in this Newsweek article that addresses the Eric Swalwell claims. If we scroll down. Newsweek previously obtained a copy of a 2019 Chinese think tank report that ranked U.S. governors based on their view toward China. Out of the 50, 17 were labeled as friendly, 14 as ambiguous, and 6 as hardline, with the rest branded unclear. And it's obvious to anyone that's paying attention that China preferred that Biden get elected. They prefer the Democrats in power, generally speaking, because they are friendlier towards China. And it's no secret that the Trump administration has been no friend to China. And while media outlets in the United States were dismissing the Hunter Biden allegations and things like that as Russian disinformation, Russian propaganda, etc., and saying it was fake and it had no merits, and that we now know, according to the FBI, well, that we know that's being investigated by the FBI and has been for 2 years, it's no secret in China as far as these things are concerned. In fact, people openly talk about it. Unless Americans find out about it, then they take the videos down. And there's no better example of that than when this Chinese professor speaking in front of a crowd said this. Take a look.
我前面讲过，华尔街在1970年代开始对美国它的内政外交有非常强的影响力，所以我们有路径依赖，是吧？但问题是08年之后，华尔街的地位下降了，更重要的是16年之后，华尔街搞不进特朗普。为什么？很尴尬，特朗普以前对华尔街有过一次软性违约，所以双方有矛盾。当然这个细节我就不多说了，时间可能已经来不及了，是吧？ 那么这个中美贸易战过程中，他们也试图帮忙啊。据我所知，美方的朋友跟我讲，这个试图帮忙，但是啊，力有不逮啊。但现在呢，现在我们看到拜登上台了，传统的精英、政治精英啊，这个建制派，他们跟华尔街的关系是非常密切的。所以大家看到吧，拜登的儿子。 被特朗普说你在全球有什么基金公司，发现没有？谁帮他建的基金公司啊？明白吗？这里边都有买卖啊。那么，所以这个时候啊，这个时候我们以恰当的方式进行一定的这样一个表达，一个善意啊。我个人理解，当然这个受限于我的专业基础是吧？我们是从国际政治经济学的角度去理解这个事儿。那么我认为啊，有它的战术和政治的价值在里边。
So as you can see in the video, the people are laughing when Joe Biden is brought up because they understand that he is bought and paid for. They understand that he will do what Wall Street tells them. And then when it comes to Hunter Biden as well, they understand that China is greasing the wheels of the Biden administration via his corrupt son, and that they fund these foundations and so forth and things like that. That's effectively what he's admitting to. And people laugh about it. They clap about it because they all know the deal. Even though we pretend here in the United States, especially the media class, pretends like it's Russian disinformation, it's none of this, it's not true at all or anything, even though we find out that the FBI is investigating things related to this for 2 years now and confirms the story is true. So let's continue on our little journey of Chinese influence in the United States, going now more towards the academic institutions and their operations of these Confucius Institutes. As we can see here from the U.S. Department of State, Confucius Institute U.S. Center designation as a foreign mission. Confucius Institutes are clearly sponsored by Beijing. Confucius Institutes are organizations primarily located on U.S. college and university campuses that push out skewed Chinese language and cultural training for U.S. students as part of Beijing's multifaceted propaganda effort. The PRC government partially funds these programs under guidance from the CCP's United Front Work Department. And if we scroll down, we can see a 2019 study by researchers from the University of College Dublin, summarized in an op-ed in the Washington Post, found that after a Confucius Institute opens, there is statistically significant shift in the tone of local media stories in the PRC's favor in the area where the CI is located. In 2014, the American Association of University Professors warned that Confucius Institutes further the political goals of Beijing's leadership and threaten the independence and integrity of academic institutions. Another way the Chinese target academia is by trying to acquire our talent and steal our intellectual property. One example is this Harvard professor, which we can see here from the United States Department of Justice. Harvard University professor and two Chinese nationals charged in three separate China-related cases. The DOJ announced today that the chair of Harvard University's Chemistry and Chemical Biology Department and two Chinese nationals have been charged in connection with aiding the People's Republic of China. Dr. Charles Lieber, 60, chair of the Department of Chemistry and Chemical Biology at Harvard University, was arrested this morning and charged by criminal complaint with one count of making materially false, fictitious, and fraudulent statements. Lieber will appear this afternoon before Magistrate Judge Marianne B. Bowler in federal court in Boston, Massachusetts. And this is basically dealing with him getting $15 million or so in grant funding from China and not disclosing that to the United States government and lying about it when asked about it. And he was a strategic scientist at the Wuhan Institute of Technology, and this was part of China's Thousand Talents program, where they actively target U.S. academics, professors, scientists, things like that, to help improve their country in order to place themselves in a more competitive position against the United States. Moving on to more recent examples of Chinese espionage against Americans in the United States, we can see here from The Guardian, revealed China suspected of spying on Americans via Caribbean phone networks. China appears to have used mobile phone networks in the Caribbean to surveil U.S. mobile phone subscribers as part of its espionage campaign against Americans, according to a mobile network security expert who has analyzed sensitive signals data. So when Americans go abroad to vacation in places like the Caribbean, for example, you can bet that the Chinese have systems in place in order to spy on you via your phone. But it's not only abroad, even here in the United States, when you use certain applications. For example, we can see in this story from the New York Post, China-based executive charged with sabotaging Zoom conferences. A China-based ex-executive at Zoom has been charged with sabotaging virtual commemorations of the Tiananmen Square massacre and breaching the security of U.S.-based users, Brooklyn federal prosecutors announced Friday. And this deals with a man by the name of Xinjiang Jin, also known as Julian Jin, and he worked in China as an executive for Zoom. He was tasked with monitoring the platform for what the mainland Chinese government considered illegal meetings that discussed political and religious subjects. At the behest of the People's Republic of China, Jin and uncharged co-conspirators infiltrated conferences and allegedly terminated at least four video meetings commemorating the 31st anniversary of the Tiananmen Square massacre since January 2019. And here you have Zoom, a company based in the United States, headquartered in San Jose, California, that still has this Chinese influence coming in and imposing their values and their laws on United States citizens and monitoring them just like they would people in China. Now, I could go on forever about different examples of Chinese influence in the West when it comes to here in the United States or even our neighbor to the north, Canada, for example, with this, military exercises that Trudeau was upset that they ended. But why do I talk about this? Well, because somebody has to. The media barely talks about it. They want to focus on Russia because they're obsessed with that narrative because it makes Trump look bad, or they want to make Trump look bad, even though he's on the way out. And I'm hoping as we move forward as a country, we can kind of leave that behind and really come together to focus on the problem that is China and how it affects all of us. Because when it comes to the experts, they seem to recognize China as the bigger threat compared to Russia, but some of the media class and the elite political establishment haven't seemed to come around just yet. As we can see in this opinion article from the Director of National Intelligence, John Ratcliffe, China is national security threat number one. Resisting Beijing's attempt to reshape and dominate the world is the challenge of our generation. And he says here, if I could communicate one thing to the American people from this unique vantage point, it is that the People's Republic of China poses the greatest threat to America today and the greatest threat to democracy and freedom worldwide since World War II. Similarly, FBI Director Christopher Wray says, the threat posed by the Chinese government and the Chinese Communist Party to the economic and national security of the United States, the greatest long-term threat to our nation's information and intellectual property and to our economic vitality, is the counterintelligence and economic espionage threat from China. It's a threat to our economic security and, by extension, to our national security. But unfortunately, sometimes recognizing this very basic fact can get you in trouble in Washington. And that's exactly what happened, for example, with respect to Michael Flynn, because he thought that China was clearly a bigger threat and that compared to China, Russia was fairly irrelevant. This raised alarm bells for Susan Rice, who then basically suspected that Michael Flynn was an agent of the Russians. As we can see here from Susan Rice's testimony, but frankly, we spent a lot more time talking about China, in part because General Flynn's focus was on China as our principal overarching adversary. He had many questions and concerns about China, and when I sought to elicit his perspective on Russia, he was quite, I started to say dismissive, but that may be an overstatement. He downplayed his assessment of Russia as a threat to the United States. He called it overblown. He said they're a declining power, they're demographically challenged, they're not really much of a threat, and then re-emphasized the importance of China. And based on things like that, Susan Rice decided to withhold information from Michael Flynn, you know, obviously in addition to a few other things, of course, like his engagements with Ambassador Kislyak and whatnot, which I guess she wasn't even supposed to really know about, but I guess that might have been revealed from the unmasking and things like that. I don't know. It gets complicated. Anyways, the point is, Flynn knew that China was the bigger threat. Russia, compared to China, is fairly irrelevant. And the focus should really be on China. And it just sucks that this has to be a political issue. It should really just be an acknowledgement of fact that if we want to survive as a country, if we still want to be the superpower, the economic powerhouse of the world, and not be taken over by China in that respect, then we kind of have to come together and agree on the facts and come up with a plan to protect our place in the world. Anyways, guys, I hope that wasn't too drawn out. I mean, things just kept coming up for this video, like story after story after story. In the span of a week, so many things happened with respect to China and the United States, and much of it wasn't covered by the media, so I felt like I should make this video. I hope you enjoyed it. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Social media links are in the description box below, as well as merch. Support us at nuancebro.com/join, and I'll see you next time, bro.